And before that, an in-depth study of the work of the great abstract filmmakers whose ideas were often plundered by cinema's mainstream.
There is an area of film which has absolutely nothing to do with multi-million dollar movie productions. Oh, finally, I mean, you know, it just seems to me that here for the first time in human history, about 100 years ago now, we have the possibility to exteriorize moving visual thinking. Mind that are unnameable but are certainly ordered and have a grammar of a sort and do reflect directly our whole emotional being constantly, haven't ever had a way to be expressed or exteriorized. And in a way, it's kind of mad that all that humans could basically think to do with that new possibility for a century was to use it to as an extension of a stage drama or moving picture illustrations for a novel, as a comic book aesthetic, essentially. So there's a form of film that's trying to evolve that area of thinking that's I call moving visual thinking. And it is intrinsically a visual music. Though, let me say this, finally you have to again stop at some point and say, well, film is not music.
The longing or the dream to have a visual music, which would be comparable to auditory music, would be flexible, fluid, and so forth, I think is an ancient one, and it's something that people all over the world share. And in that field, Oscar Fischinger is perhaps the first great genius that we can see and appreciate. And the film allowed Oscar Fischinger to preserve some of his best work, and that has influenced a whole generation of other people in preparing really beautiful visual music works. Study films are the first series of works that Oscar prepared, which are exactly synchronized with sound, with musical sound. And he had the idea that these black and white films could be synchronized with music, which on one hand would make it easier for people to understand them, because everyone hears music and it's an abstract art form, but you don't say, hey, what's that supposed to be? You know, it's not a car horn, it's not a bird, what is this? You just accept it's an oboe or it's a singer. So that abstract quality of music, he thought by making a parallel between the auditory music and his visual music, it would be easier for people to understand the abstraction, the pure abstraction of it. First and last, devoted to the abstract image, to the non-objective image, to be more specific in that fine art sense of the pure geometric abstraction that's not related to any kind of external reality or any other imagery.
Approach to the art of light and motion by Charles Dockham, illumination engineer. This is the mobile color projector, an instrument complex in its engineering, yet simple in its operation, to allow the artist-composer wide freedom of movement and design.
We're able to see in that color organ the enormous potential of live color projection as opposed to film. But when you see a color organ like Dockham's and the intensity and the magic of the pure light hanging in space in the room, you're impressed with how much more subtle that is in some way than the potential of cinema for producing a light spectacle.
This then is mobile color, a new, living, growing, changing, non-objective art form. A marriage of art and science for color symphonies. Since this is a complete art form in itself, there will be no spoken word or music to accompany this next portion.
to try to explain what the experience of a visual experience, how a visual experience can parallel or appear to be compatible with the our experience of music. First place, the things that I'd seen, the filmmakers, the experimental avant-garde filmmakers, Oscar Fischinger and the early color ordnance people, didn't seem any of them to be doing what I thought would really be a musical experience, a visually musical experience, a visual musical experience. I don't know exactly how to say it. We had devised a means of animation, not drawing, but a means of manipulating paper cutouts one over another. And we developed pantographs and various ways to control the action of these cutouts, allowing light below to pass through some sort of a space in the cutout to be registered on the camera. We were manipulating these all one frame at a time. At the same time, also, we had devised this, I had invented this idea of a pendulum swinging to generate a variable area soundtrack. And with that hardware, our own invention and our own homemade hardware, it was possible for us now then to sit aside from our hardware and with pages of, like, accounting pages, ruled lines and vertical lines to mark out the starting and the stopping of the swing of the pendulum, or the starting and the stopping of the motion of these pentagraph manipulations, and literally score a composition. A progressive drifting apart of my brother and myself because of two different attitudes. I admire his carrying on with a film career. That's exactly what he did. He improved from each composition after the other in successive form. He improved his skills at manipulating a form of symbolism. And his interests were the implications, the spiritual, the emotional implications, and a continuation of his refinement of his own career of making these kind of films.
He became more and more deeply involved in a sort of spiritual climate because he was trying to come to terms with his own, you know, his own life and his own sense of responsibility. And the result of that are two films which are enormously well thought out and enormously refined, Yantra and Lapis, both of which have spiritual references in their title. Yantra, the cosmic machine or the meditational machine in Sanskrit, and Lapis, the philosopher's stone of alchemy. He became very much conscious of trying to create an art which expressed fundamental conditions of being and made people think more about their relationship to the cosmos as a whole. Also simultaneously made the decision to limit the element of his artwork to the dot. And Yantra is entirely hand-drawn with dots on little 5x7 cards, so that you see elements in them sometimes because of the way he hand-developed the film in his bathtub, solarized it and so forth. So you see other textures and other colors, but the basis is always that hand-drawn dot. Relationship between visual music in terms of color organs and performances and the filmmaking is very intricate and goes through all the filmmakers, I think. Jordan Belson, for example, starts as a painter, decides to make films because of his of seeing Oscar Fischinger and his relationship with James Whitney and Harry Smith and other young painters who decided to make abstract films in the 40s and early 50s. Then he himself begins to work in projections in the planetarium in San Francisco in the mid-50s, does these elaborate vortex concerts in which they're able to project imagery on the dome of the planetarium with quadraphonic electronic music sound scores. Some of the early footage with this sort of geometric quality reminds one of the starscapes and so forth that would have been in the planetarium. In fact, Jordan created many of the images in his later films, a film like Light or Phenomena or Reentry. You have a lot of images that are created from optical phenomena that result from the distortion of light coming from different real, if you would, realistic sources, that is reflected light, mirrors, transformation of reflections, different things like this, which create cloudy, amorphous nuances of color, of shape, of movement, which suggest celestial phenomena and spiritual states of one kind or another. Harry Smith was another of those painters who were doing abstract painting and at the time and were convinced by Fischinger and by seeing the Fischinger works at the Art and Cinema in the San Francisco Museum that, in fact, visual music, the control of the time element through film, was a very important element and that it superseded plain easel painting. So Harry Smith drew directly on the film, and he used those immediately as a form of public projection.
He was listening to a lot of jazz and was inspired by that and creating the work with that in mind, and in fact performing it or playing the films and where jazz musicians were improvising live with the work. And then later years he would actually just put on a record and let the record play, and people would make their own sort of connections between the sonic events and the visual events.
Thank you.
There are probably as many different ways of producing what is called abstract imagery on film as there are filmmakers working. And in fact, each filmmaker evolves and changes in different ways his or her making an approach. And I'd say the only thing that holds these various techniques together, whether consciously or not, is some sense of internal thought process or hypnagogic closed-eye vision. And so this is what I share with Len Lai, that who began as a painter, as you know, and a batik artist, and who then batiked onto film, a process that he felt in the mind, and who believed deeply, as I do share with him, that so-called more primitive peoples were more directly in touch with the very cell lives of their minds, of their nervous systems, and expressed directly onto their shields and their pots and their various decorations patterns that are intrinsic to inner thought processes. He believed the cells were directly expressing their lives through his work, and finally how he sat and expressed his own dying of cancer, etching on leader what the cells themselves were, as he believed it, telling him of their dissolution and his imminent death in Particles in Space, his last testament. Music was made at probably the greatest crisis in my life, when a 29-year marriage was with five children raised was dissolving and splitting into divorce. And I really didn't expect to live to survive that. And understandably, I was very aware of my closed-eye vision at that time, of the deep sadness or the night that of despair that was enveloping me. And despite my unhappiness and confusion, I couldn't help but notice that in this dark night of the soul, so to speak, there were great beauties of closed-eye vision that sprang up in the hypnagogic feedback of my optic system. And so I began to paint those. I started painting on 8mm, which is about the size of this fingernail. 35 is about the size of a thumbnail. An IMAX frame is 8 35mm frames, about that. So it's, to me, mural work. It's a mural, you know. And so I start, I lay out an acrylic puddle on that, and with the colors that I'm on that frame that I'm kneading. And then add chemicals, most of them simple household chemicals, such as, say, Clorox or Santa Flush. And I affect chemically that paint, what shapes it's going into. I lay down Vaseline, for instance, to cause the paint to slip off certain areas and not be affected. So finally, what you could say is I'm a gardener of a chemical and paint growth process. And then I do each frame, make the gardens so that that 24 of them will make an articulation of vision across a space of time.
Abstract cinema would be something that a painter would put the aesthetic image into motion. Simple as that. My basic elements is always the line. Then the line can become a shape, then the shape becomes a form. But primarily I'm dealing with line on paper and the way I would rhythmically make that work, and one against the other. So you really are a choreographer. You're a graphic choreographer. That's what you are. And that's what I'm all about. So I just call it landscape because it would be a very simple line and let people find their way into the landscape or out of this landscape. But primarily, it's really color-filled painting. In other words, if you're walking through a gallery, you stop, stay, then you move on. But here, I don't allow you all, any and all that time. I simply give you maybe 8 frames, maybe I give you 12 frames, and then away there, the colors react to each other. It's another picture. So primarily I am giving you the time to look at a color. And this is your problem then to find your way out.
I've never been particularly intrigued with the notion of film music. I don't really... I've just never felt that I had anything to contribute to that. I find that I experience music in one way and pictures in another, and more often than not I'm like making a soundtrack that may be musical or not, but it's like getting at something in the picture that's not doesn't really relate to it formally. Maybe it relates emotionally or historically or something, or contrast with it. I'm really more interested in sort of creating problems or creating tensions that are interesting in some way or other than in reinforcing something that exists in another medium. I think that's what it is. First time I saw Len Lai's Trade Tattoo, this was after I'd been doing some experiments that paralleled that, and having no idea that someone had done that in 1934. This would have been about 1960, and Lai would take a picture of something like a grain thresher, and make it into two color fields that interacted, a yellow one and a green one, I remember distinctly. And he would get at the sort of energy that comes between flatness and depth, and allow these colors to do whatever perceptual thing they're going to do that works against the picture. I have always been interested in trying to question the movie screen in a similar way, to sort of set up a question about, is it an illusion or is it an object? Does it exist on the flat screen or is it in the perspective and the representation that seems to be behind the screen? This film was made mostly out of bits of stock footage, commercials, and documentaries, and also stuff that I shot. In a way, it's like taking devalued imagery and cooking it in a way that it may turn into some other kind of experience, and maybe that sort of parallel to what perhaps it's what we do with our memories of images, in a way that we tend to see it all and pack it all away and in a dream state or somewhere between consciousness and unconsciousness we have a vision once in a while, and that's the sort of thing that I'm trying to recreate, that it's something you imagine, you see, and by the time you figure out what it is, it's gone. And when you start thinking about abstract and the tradition of abstract film and how there are other people who have done things that aren't really in that tradition, but they're equally abstract, and they're like taking a notion about film and extending it way beyond where it had been before. One is a Michael Snow film called The Central Region, which is a very long piece that involves a whole elaboration of camera movement, of repetitive and continued camera movement over the same situation and landscape, and how you spend time with this film and you begin to feel almost as if you're in the camera. It's almost like the auditorium is the camera and it's moving, and you start seeing things passing through the frame in a way that's musical, that's dance-like, in a way that like evokes all sorts of other experiences. And to me, I mean, that's very much an abstract film.
I think that the issues of abstraction are much more to do with the question of how you deal with time. Because of the way in which abstract cinema grew up at the time that there was abstract painting, a lot of the first assumptions were that this was to do with bringing ideas from painting into cinema. And I think that was a slight misconception of what can be done in the concept of abstraction in cinema. Someone like Léger, for example, had no problem that he used images that came from the real world. And then the abstraction was in the way in which he sequenced and organized that. But what I think is important in this is the idea that it isn't necessarily something that's non-representational in the image, which defines that as being abstract in cinematic terms. I think in the visual arts, there was a strong part of the development of abstraction, which was a rejection of the conventional perspective as the way in which you model the image of the world. Now, the equivalent of that in for me in abstract cinema is the rejection of narrative structure as the way in which you model the world. And as with the visual artists, they needed to look for another form of logic. They dispense with the logic of perspective for constructing their picture. We as in a sense abstract filmmakers or video makers have got to look for another form of logic for the construction of the time of our visual, of our images, of our sequences. And I think that the one model we obviously go to is the model of music. But in a sense, you don't want to always be drawing from another art form. You're looking really for a model that is more appropriate to your art form and which relates to the sorts of things which go on in that medium. And certainly for me now, a number of the concepts which are coming out of computing are very valuable as starting points for time structures. I think a lot of the most interesting European work is work that has within it representational images. And the sort of people who I think are very important in this, a particular favourite of mine, I mean Kurt Kren, film like TV, which is totally a cinematic visual representation. I mean, it's a photographic image, but the whole point of the abstraction in that is the way in which he's working with time and with you as a viewer's expectancy about time and the way in which he resequences images, which it clearly did have some sort of continuity. And the abstraction is in the way in which he's handling that development of internal rhythms in the shots and the rhythms of the editing and the montage. Viking Eggling, I think, is an extremely interesting starting point for a certain set of developments in cinema. Firstly, he does take up the musical model in trying to find a way in which he can use abstract images in a cinematic framework. He's looking at a musical model, and he had a fairly substantial theory which he was developing, ground base of art, looking for a sort of structural concept which would allow him to organize time in the same degree of logic or the same degree of structure as might have been organized through narrative. And he, I think, makes the first stage in what has become a major development of abstract cinema, which is the abstract cinema that's related to working with computers. Eggling's work is, I think, the first example of work which could have been programmed. His work is almost programmable. I could actually sit down with a computer, take his images and write a program which would generate work which was very like Eggling. And the reason is that he was actually looking for a logic. And that logic, though he started from music, in a way wasn't a musical logic. It became much more like a kind of programmed mathematical logic. The image is totally synthesized from the computer. There's no element of that which comes from, in a sense, from the outside world, and it doesn't represent the outside world at all. Nonetheless, it develops a certain kind of logical process. That piece is also an interactive piece. It's like a visual synthesizer. I mean, that really follows on a big tradition of attempting to make light organs. It's a very similar sort of approach to trying to do with color and light what musicians have always done with written music and with performed music, that the light becomes the elements of the abstraction in the same way that the note becomes is the element of abstraction in sound. So this piece begins not from any representation, it's as totally synthesized.
I find the work that I'm doing relates to the early traditions in absolute cinema in that it shares some of the same goals for creating effect through absolute form in motion, dealing with color and meanings generated purely by color. One of the differences in my approach to that of the early film animators was that I have the luxury of working with electronic tools which enable me to generate my images in real time. One of the things the computer can offer is infinite control over the generation of your forms, a chance to work in very complex ways, very complex rhythmic patterns, repetitions of patterns and variations that are very difficult to do, let's say, in a real-time performance like I'm used to doing. And they offers an artist working in absolute animation a kind of power that wasn't available in film. It's a much simpler process in a way now to generate a long body of work.
I have in this system right here the capability to manipulate a field of points, those same points that Jim was working with at the very beginning, that our mechanical machine would work with. Now I can manipulate these points in a vast new and much more fluid way. But these points are determined by differential distributions of a kind of a geometry. And that geometry is intimately related to the ratio relationships of the musical scale. Now I have the capacity to do those kind of manipulations in real time with a color palette as broad as I want to make it, thousands of different colors, and to play them, to compose them, and see them played back to me immediately.
I worked with simple abstraction. I worked with simple geometric shapes on the computer because of the mathematical base of computers. And geometric shapes are simple mathematical constructs. And so I've worked with abstraction to reference technology. I have also worked with abstraction in that I have taken images from nature and altered them. I am interested in how we understand our visual world, but seeing it in a way that I've never seen it before, to try to arrive at some new experience of it. My new work, Maya, is a stereoscopic computer animation that, like most of my works, works on more than one level. It's structured musically, again with loops, and arriving at temporal complexity from careful structuring. It explores perceptual paradox, because there are things that happen in the computer world where I'm modeling our stereoscopic perception that cannot exist in the physical world. And this is one of the things I'm interested about working with computers, is expanding our experience beyond that of our physical limitations. I think it's important for artists to chart the new territory. People with imaginations are needed to really find what the real potential of any new technology is. And to understand these images is also going to require a visual education. And who knows more about images than artists do?
I think abstract cinema has a hard time being seen in a world where there is so much imagery that is often based on those very same works and people and ideas that's simply all around us now. And it's hard to set something aside enough from the rest of the world for someone to pay attention to it.
The advertising industry has changed a lot. Julius Pinchever in the Germany in the 20s and 30s allowed the film artists, Lottie Reiniger, Walter Ruttmann, Oscar Fischinger, and so forth, to make the film they wanted to make, and it only had to be related to the product by an end title of some sort. And Len Lai, working for the GPO, could also make an abstract film if he wanted and then sort of put in the letter saying mail early. But that's not true anymore. Now the advertising agencies have psychological advisors and audience testing, and they demand that you see so many minutes of the label, and it has to be integrated. In many cases, even make out whole storyboards saying, do this, animate these images in this order. So you're not doing a creative work anymore the way the artist could in the 20s and 30s.
Clearly, the things which were considered abstract and unacceptably abstract 20 or 30 years ago are now almost commonplace. And it's not just MTV. I mean, it's in advertising. It's in commercial cinema, even, that, you know, some of those things have become recuperated, if you like. So, that's just the normal pattern, I think, of new languages and new ideas do take some time to filter into the kind of mainstream language. And I think that pop videos might be like that. So I think it's a question that we become more popularly, more visually accustomed to things which at a certain stage we reject.
Abstraction in film is perhaps a nostalgic form, especially for younger people, in a way, that come across work that was done way before them, as it was for me when I found, like, the first Fischinger film I had ever seen. that it reverberates in a way that is probably totally different than it was when it was made. I mean, it was made as something that looked toward the future, and we see it now as something that's part of the past, and it's still a delicious experience, but it has a totally different sort of perspective.
Next tonight, complete works by four of the abstract filmmakers featured in this program. Next Monday at 11 o'clock, Global Image shows the struggle of the Canadian Mohawk Indians in the summer of 1990 as they struggle to regain their lost land rights.